so we're pleased to be able to welcome today wonderful mezzo-soprano, Mirjam Frank, and this happens to be a really wonderful recitative aria for mezzo-soprano from the auditorium of St. Ludmilla. And then the biblical songs of Dvořák, all 10 of them, because they provide especially good example for the treatment of the words in songs, and also because they're just something for New York, composed here in New York. Now, these works were both composed to Czech words, and they've been published, each of these works has been published twice with different English translations. In the case of Ludmilla, the very first performance was in England, and it was performed in an English translation, but everybody complained about the translation, it was terrible. Anyway, as I studied these pieces myself, I decided that I would try my hand. I thought maybe I could make a better English translation than the ones that have been published. And I think I succeeded. I really worked hard at it, trying to give, actually reproduce for an English-speaking audience the effect that a Czech-speaking audience has in listening to this music. Now, in the case of Ludmilla, you know, just every step of the way in my research, I find evidence to support this whole thesis that Dvořák really was a wonderful vocal composer, and that he really was very interested in texts, even if you might think that he wouldn't be. In the case of Ludmilla, I went and studied the original manuscript of the libretto written by Jaroslav Verklitsky, and in this libretto you find pages like this, where everything has changed, something's crossed out, and words are inserted. Up in the upper right, you give a whole new paragraph inserted there. That, by the way, is inserted in Dvořák's hand. As Dvořák said, he couldn't write. He was not like Wagner, he couldn't write. And he did not compose what's written there, but he got Verklitsky to write it, and he sent it to him in a letter, and Dvořák wrote it into the libretto. So Dvořák wanted to get the text just right. The oratorio of St. Ludmilla is from Czech history, and I will say something about it in the program notes, but just very briefly, it's about the conversion of this saint, Ludmilla, to Christianity, and her betrothal to Prince Borzovoy, who then also accepted the Christian faith. It takes place in the 19th century AD, and this is the beginning of the Christianity in Bohemia, you could say. The first part of the oratorio takes place in the town of Mělník, north of Prague. It is where Ludmilla lived. She was a princess in some noble family and a devotee of the pagan religion. But there's a dramatic scene where a hermit, Ivan, comes to the castle and proclaims the word of Christ and strikes down a statue of a goddess that they had just erected there in Mělník. Well, Ludmilla is all enthralled by this Ivan, and it resolves to go and seek him out where he lives. She takes with her companion, Svatova, and it's the aria, the recitative aria of Svatova that we're going to hear. This is the second part of the oratorio. It takes place where Ivan lives, and it's a real place, which happens to be not too far from where I live, outside of Prague. And so one day my partner Tomáš, who loves to take pictures, went out and took some pictures on a day when there was fog, and it captures perfectly the atmosphere that is depicted in this recitative aria we're going to hear. This is a big cliff. It's kind of like being in the high mountains there, but this is around fog, not far away. And this is what it looks like. It's called Svatyan Plotskal. It's a real place. Let's see. This is a picture we're actually going to project during the performance. It's an exact whistle, so that's about what they're singing about. But I just wanted to say something in particular about the text. This is what we're going to hear. This is in my English translation, and I've tried to make it as faithful as I can to the meaning of the Czech words, and even to get the important words at the same place where Dvořák has them in his music. Very interesting. She's scared to death, this Svatova, because it's a real scary place. Dark and gloomy forest shadows, my lady, she's addressing Ludmilla. What dark and gloomy forest shadows makes now thy war? Young cliffs rise up to jagged summits like grim interior vanguards. In horror, in the beasts do flee.
And wait until you hear how Dvořák sets this. Oh, it is so atmospheric and so captivating. In horror, even the beast who's beautifully not what echoes in the crags you're waiting. It's just like you're hearing the echoes of the beasts coming from those cliffs. And the harmony is just, oh, it just really wrenches you. My heart is seized by fear and terror. No, with thee I'll not go on. No, with thee I shall not go on. No. But then comes kind of a pause for reflection. She gets control of herself, and she begins the aria. And she says, I should not have thee trusted formerly. When thou led me here to gloomy crags, I should not. And then she recalls the story of the hermit coming to the castle of Melnik. Yea, thou dost know, since that aged man he did appear at Melnik's gate, all through that sort of flood of stress and woe hath whirled, you cannot rest. Then she describes the strange magic, and again, the harmonies that Dvořák uses. As you listen to this, you are in the power of this magic. That strange magic from that man's words, that like a stormy flash of light streamed, how it overwhelmed thee, how it conquered thee. And you know, she's starting to understand what this is all about as she says this. She's starting to realize that this is, you know, it's not just for no good reason that Ludmilla has brought her to this horrible place. And so she says, how from the castle it drove thee, that strange magic. What power for thy journey it gave thee, transformed thy day and all thy dreaming. How firm and stride thy feeble legs. At that point, Dvořák has a pedal point in the bass that keeps repeating, and it is indeed very firm sounding. And at this point, it's wonderful. It all makes a wonderfully rounded form musically. He goes back to the music of the opening, and yet she is now seeing everything from a completely different point of view. The transition back to the opening.
Piece is in F major. This aria is in F major. So how does one normally get back to F major? One has maybe a dominant chord, and then goes back to F major. Well, this is no ordinary return. This is like a return that's not a return. It's a return into a world that is now a new world, seen in a completely different way.
Thank you.